Look, I like benches and torture tests just as much as the next guy. But put all that aside, because in this video, I'm going to share 25 functional, practical, and useful 3D prints that will not only put your 3D printer to the test, but will each challenge you to learn a new and important skill that every 3D printing enthusiast has to learn. Instead of wasting kilos of filament on useless junk, I've chosen a series of prints that test you and your printer on each of the different skills involved in 3D printing, from bed adhesion and retraction to advanced slicer settings and flexible materials, all while leaving you with a practical part that you can actually use when you're done. It's a veritable triathlon of 3D printing. Can you print them all? Will you? Let's dive in. Let's start our list off with one single functional part, but a part which will absolutely rigorously test four different aspects of your 3D printer's performance, settings, and tuning. Behold, the Tupperware Lid Organizer. I know. At first glance, it might seem like a pretty innocuous print. It holds up and organizes your Tupperware lids. Big whoop, right? But look again. You see, because of the veins sticking up, this print actually serves as a phenomenal torture test of filament retraction, almost like those retraction tests that people love to print, but in a more practical form. If your printer has any issues with stringing, this part will definitely bring them to light. And because each layer is so quick as you get to the veins, it will also expose any cooling issues you might have too. Plus, because the veins stick up so high on the larger model, this is also a phenomenal test of the belt tension and stiffness on your 3D printer, not to mention helping you identify if you have any Z wobble caused by a bent lead screw. If all that is Greek to you, well, don't worry. It basically just means that because of the tall, pointy bits on this print is going to be great for diagnosing whether or not you have any issues with something called Z-banding, which causes ribbing or banding on long, tall prints. Finally, add to all this the fact that this print has large, square surfaces with 90-degree corners, and you also have a fantastic bed adhesion test, juxtaposed with the cooling test of the upper layers. If your corners bend or warp, you either have poor bed adhesion or you need to turn down part cooling during earlier layers, or both. Four different aspects of 3D printer performance and knowledge tested in just one super functional part. Pretty cool, right? If you agree, then don't forget to preheat that like button, would ya? All right. Are you ready? Because this next one will test three different skills that, as you can see, often trip up even the most seasoned 3D printing enthusiasts. I'm talking about these customized drinking glass labels. Why are they useful? Well, since printing these out for every member of my family, plus some for guests, I've reduced the number of times I need to run the dishwasher in our household by like 40%. Okay, but what's challenging about them? Oh, sweet, sweet summer child. First of all, in order to actually make these cool and custom, you'll need to tackle OpenSCAD, a software that lets you customize 3D print files without doing any modeling. Now, if that's a little bit overwhelming, don't worry, because I actually have a video coming out about that next week. So generously apply glue to the subscribe button to make sure that you don't miss out on that video. In addition to OpenSCAD modeling, this 3D print requires you to tackle flexible filaments to prevent the model from snapping in half when you press it fit onto your glasses. Plus, in order to accurately adapt the model to the various different glasses in your house, you're going to need to test your skills at precision measurement using a vernier caliper. Don't have a set? Well, check out my video in the link below with a full list of the tools you need to level up your 3D printing workflow. Finally, because this model is split down the middle and printed with notoriously stringy TPU filament, it serves as a seriously challenging retraction test, as well as a crash course in the importance of drying your hygroscopic filament. As you can see here, my TPU was not nearly as dry as I thought it was, forcing me to dehydrate and reprint these models. Without a doubt, these are a couple of my absolute favorite 3D prints, and I use them for honestly everything. From pill containers, cue Food Safe Army in the comments below, to earplug containers, to storing knickknacks, and more. But beyond being a supremely useful print, these containers also serve as a fantastic test of your 3D printer. First of all, because they screw together, they test the dimensional accuracy of your printer, particularly whether or not you are over or under extruding. What's more, this little knurling on the side of them requires that your printer constantly retract the filament and put little dots of filament over and over again, which tests your retraction settings and just begs for nozzle clogging if they're not dialed in. Finally, because the walls are so thin and under stress when you screw and unscrew the container, this is a great way to test your layer adhesion and print temperatures. I love these cable organizers, largely because I really hate dangling cables everywhere. Now, while this might seem like a silly, simple print, it's not. First of all, you'll need to use flexible filaments if you want it to work smoothly and cleanly. That, combined with the fact that they have these very tight slits, also means that you'll need retraction dialed in properly. And because infill versus additional perimeters have vastly different effects on how much squish you actually get in which areas of the print, this will also force you to learn about the difference and play around with slicer settings to get it just right. But when you do get it right, these are super useful prints that you'll want to keep extras of on hand. By the way, while we're organizing our cables, let's jump to these little cable organizers if you notice them in the frame. And they help you organize your cables when they're not in use. Now, I only recently discovered these cable organizers, but let me tell you, they're quickly becoming some of my favorite prints. Oftentimes, 3D printed gadgets like this don't work all that well because they're too fragile or they have lots of mechanical friction, but not these. These are smooth and easy to use as they are practical, and I absolutely love them. What's more, they actually offer a bunch of fun tests for your 3D printer. First, the tight tolerances of the lid and the snap-on tabs test the dimensional accuracy of your printer and extruder. Once again, the thin walls on the body, which will be under pressure when the cable is inserted, test layer adhesion. The split spines and cable slit test retraction, and finally, because you'll inevitably need to change the dimensions and scale them non-proportionally to fit different types of cables or drawers, they are a great introduction to customizing prints within your slicer. Now, you'll probably notice that most of these prints so far are pretty low tech, but 3D printing doesn't have to be. In fact, with something as simple as a custom PCB and a little bit of wiring, you could create literally anything you want, from a 3D printed robotic dog that looks and works like the $50,000 Boston Dynamics robot, to a complete retro handheld gaming console, to even a micro handheld resin 3D printer. But in the past, getting custom PCBs has been really hard and expensive with huge minimum order quantities. Fortunately, that's no longer an issue thanks to today's sponsor, PCBWay. PCBWay allows you to upload your own custom PCBs and order as few as 10 of them for just $5. You don't know how to design PCBs? No worries, because you just check out their library of amazing projects where you can order the PCBs that others have uploaded and follow along with their instructions. So check them out in the description below and get a discount on your first order and support this channel in doing so. Big thanks to PCBWay for your support. All right, back to the video. And since we're on the topic of mixing technology and 3D printing, let's talk about this tablet stand that I have standing here. And I hope you're ready for a tough one. See, obviously, it's very functional. I'm actually using it so I can see my monitor right on here. But I also want you to know that it is a pain in the you-know-what to print properly. And here's why. First, because it uses these 3D printed nuts and screws with extremely tight tolerances in order to maximize tension, it simply won't fit together properly if your dimensions are off. I, for example, tried to print it on my Voron 2.4 before finishing a thorough extruder calibration and pressure advance, and the parts just didn't fit. You'll see I actually had to glue them together in order to get it to hold the iPad so I could film here. And the little friction divots were nowhere near precise enough to actually catch on one another and provide adjustable ratcheting. So as you can see, I literally had to glue this thing together with some 3D glue to get it in a fixed position enough so I could just use it until I have time to print another one. On top of that, there's obviously a lot of tension on this entire thing due to the weight on it, the tiny snap-on fins that go under it, which if your print strength isn't dialed in, or if again, the holes are too tight because of extrusion issues, they'll break. Finally, this large base with minimal surface area actually touching the bed is a great way not only to test bed adhesion, but also first layer quality. All in all, you can definitely tell that I printed this on a printer that was not yet fully calibrated. And it was because of this part, actually, not because of the bunches of benches or other functional parts I did, that I realized how off my extrusion was, and I was able to diagnose and fix it. Now, I don't know about all of you, but I do a lot of drilling around the house, and when I do, I make a god-awful mess doing it. Fortunately, I discovered this simple drill dust collector, which does exactly what the name suggests. Now, you might think that this is a simple print, and quite frankly, you'd be right. But that doesn't stop it from challenging your 3D printer. In fact, this was one of the first prints I did on the Bamboo Lab X1 Carbon, and it was because of this print that I realized how finicky the cool plate can be when it comes to bed adhesion. Now that's because this is a relatively tall print with a large, flat, square surface area that will curl up if it's cooled too much too fast. But conversely, the bottom of this print hasn't been designed as well as it could have for 3D printing. Instead of using chamfered edges, 45 degree angles, it uses filleted edges or rounded ones. And those round edges on the build plate are really hard overhangs for your 3D printer, and so they require an insane amount of cooling to get right. But with that insane early cooling, it means everything is likely to curl off the print surface. In short, this is a challenging print for even the best printers on the market, and it will bring to light any bed adhesion issues that you didn't even think you had. Here's another one that I just love. I printed off a fair number of broom holders and the like, and I'm generally really disappointed because they often lose their shape after a few months under tension. But not this one. It holds your broom or other cleaning device firmly with a satisfying snap when you insert it. It's also our first print-in-place device on the list, meaning it prints in one single piece. And that's really cool, but it also means that you need to have things like dimensional accuracy absolutely dialed in. And since it's going to be holding weight, with two screws that can easily separate the layers if they aren't fused properly, it also tests layer adhesion and strength too. As you probably noticed, I love plants and gardening, though I'm not all that good at it. In any case, these garden labels are awesome because despite being relatively simple prints, they test a few different things and develop a few very fun skills. First, because they're going to be used outside in the sun, they ideally should be printed in ASA or at least PETG, earning them an advanced filaments badge. Because of the unique and sharp shapes making contact with the print surface, they also test bed adhesion to the limits. And in order to make the text clear and legible, you're going to need to not only have your retraction dialed in, but you'll also need to play around with more advanced slicer settings, such as changing the color mid-print, and then you'll need to learn how to execute those purges, unloads, and loads to facilitate color changes on your printer, which varies from printer to printer. While we're on the topic of more advanced slicer settings, let's talk about one that every 3D printing enthusiast absolutely must know about, and that's vase mode. With this beautiful dragon scales pot and vase that I have here. In case you don't know, vase mode is when your printer does one continuous spiral line around the entire print instead of printing it layer by layer. It's a way to quickly churn out large prints, but it requires mastering a bunch of different skills. First of all, you'll need to learn how to use spiral vase mode and adjust all the other settings such as infill to match in your slicer. Then, for maximum success, you'll need to learn how to change your printer's nozzle to a larger one, ideally a 0.8 or 1.0 millimeter. Finally, because the layers happen so quickly in spiral vase mode, and because this particular model has sharp corners and overhangs, you'll need to dial in your cooling as well. The results, though, are honestly really, really beautiful. And once you've mastered spiral vase mode and all the skills that go with it, there's really no limit to how many cool things that you can print. By the way, check out my 50 plus useful things you didn't know you could 3D print video for more ideas and inspiration. This next one is an awesome test of just how strong your 3D prints are. 3D printed carabiners. While neither of these are print in place, and you definitely shouldn't go rock climbing with them, they are challenging. The tight tolerances require high dimensional accuracy, the fact that they'll be used outdoors, plus the fact that you don't want them to snap violently like PLA tends to, means that you should use advanced filaments like ASA or even nylon. The need for strength means that you'll need to play around with different parameters in your slicer that you normally don't touch, such as number of perimeters, rather than just cranking up the infill. And finally, their small surface area means that proper bed adhesion is a must. My wife and I love these because they fit nicely on our son's stroller, and you'd be shocked at how much weight they actually support. Fortunately though, because they print laying flat, they aren't actually a real test of layer adhesion or strength. A handful of years ago, I ordered a bunch of these flexible shoelace replacements and started putting them in all the shoes I could. Basically, they turn almost any shoe into a slip-on, eliminating the annoying laces that untie and making your shoes a whole lot more comfortable in the process. Unfortunately, they sometimes are not a perfect fit for your shoes, or they aren't available in all the colors that you want. But all that was before I owned a 3D printer. Now I can just run these off in any color TPU I happen to find on the internet in the exact size that I want. This of course means that I've had to master flexible filaments as well as precision measurement and retraction and filament dehydration, as well as bed adhesion due to the small nubs touching the bed, but all that was worth it. Check out these rad orange ones I just printed. Here's one that unfortunately I only discovered after my popular 3D printed tools video, which you can check out up here. It does test retraction nicely, and if you want it to be as smooth as possible, then you'll need to play around with the more advanced variable layer height feature in your slicer. Basically, this is a tray for sorting out all the different hardware you have in your office effectively. But beware, these spines sticking up have a real tendency to string, so have fun tuning your retraction, friends. Have I mentioned that I hate seeing cables? As if you didn't know from all the cable organization stuff on this list already. Fortunately, I discovered these awesome print-in-place cable organizers which tuck under your desk. Now, like all print-in-place parts, they require high dimensional accuracy, but because of the minuscule surface area on the print bed, you'll need to enable brims or level up your bed adhesion game. Plus, given the fact that the latch needs to have some compliance in order to snap on and off repeatedly, you'll want to print it in PETG, earning it the Advanced Materials badge, though only barely, and you'll want to dehydrate that filament, meaning that it'll also earn the drying filament badge. Here's one that surprised me with how tricky it actually was to print, considering I printed it on my Prusa MK3S Plus with default profiles, though admittedly I printed it in wood filament, which is really inconsistent with extrusions. It's a cup holder that holds your cup below desk level, preventing any kind of disaster. What's hard about it is that it features very tricky tolerances, especially on the screw that threads and the actual track for the clamp here. If you have even the slightest tolerance issue or over extrusion or miscalibrated E-steps, this model will let you know about it. So there you have it, my list of 15 or 25, or I honestly don't know how many anymore, functional 3D prints that will challenge you and your 3D printer to level up your skills. I'd love to know in the comments below, which ones are you planning to print? And while you're down there, please remember to like this video and subscribe to the channel. We're trying to reach 100,000 subscribers by August 30th, 2023, and we really need your help. Finally, let me take a moment to thank my Patreon supporters who make it possible for me to come back every week after week and make these 3D printing videos for all of you. If you'd like to help support the channel and earn exciting perks like discounts from participating vendors, early access to ad-free videos, and a members-only Discord, then hit the link in the description below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you on the next layer. Bye-bye.